brief tour of my messy shop. Here is a reloading press I got from a friend after his father passed away. He wasn't really interested, didn't have the time to reload ammunition, so I got that from a buddy. My powder measure, thrower, I don't know what you call it. Built a little bench out of some 18 gauge steel. There's an LVL here. I wrapped it with a piece of sheet metal. Case trimmer over there. Scale here. Here's my tumbler I made out of a Freon bottle, an old motor from a chemical mixer, a dishwasher motor and transmission. Built a little adapter plate to hook the bottle up. Some little couplings, and threw it all together. Pressed the windings out of this and cut that down enough that the original motor shaft would stick out the bottom. What happened was we lost the seal in this dishwasher transmission. Got water down into it, completely gunked the grease up, got into the motor, shorted the windings out. So I built a coupling that I could attach to that shaft, replaced the bearings and the seal in it, put some new oil in it. Currently it has walnut media in it and some brass. I use it to tumble my brass for reloading. I also use it with these lead balls here to make black powder. So I'll clean the walnut media out, throw the lead balls, the ingredients of the black powder in. And here's some homemade black powder here. What else? Some bullet molds that I've built. Two cavity 58 caliber round ball mold. Built the handles, everything for this guy. And then this is the mold for my cannon. Shoots almost a 1-inch projectile. This one I turned on the lathe just to kind of see how it would fit in the barrel out of lead. The nose isn't pointed at all. I just was after the dimension and kind of how it would look. This has got a much more pointed nose, as you can see down inside of there. This one you need both hands to get it open. The pins fit a little too good. Set this down and open it up. So that is the shape of that bullet for the cannon. So what you do is you pour the lead down that hole till it fills the little taper up, and then you open this, cuts the sprue off from the bullet so the bottom's flat, and you dump the bullet out. Let's move into the messy sheet metal shop. Here's my spot welder a guy gave to me for free when I bought another piece of equipment from him. The funky little lever here that you turned it on with, the switch was bad. So I pulled the wire out, put it down into a homemade control panel. I've got a contactor. When the foot pedal is on, pushes on that button when the tongs sets the spot welder off. A homemade press I built out of some angle iron and some flat strap that I had kicking around. Bought some bolts for it. I had the jack. I actually think I got that at a yard sale for $5. It's a 12-ton. A guy gave me a 20-ton jack, which I'm going to replace the 12-ton with the 20-ton. It was kind of copied after the ones that you'll see in Harbor Freight. I built some bushings for the rod through these flat plates, and I think I tacked them in there. Maybe I didn't. Maybe they're just sitting in there. They're probably just pressed in there. Pittsburgh machine. I first bought this when I first started my own business doing heating and air conditioning. Puts the lock on the ductwork fittings. Here's the makings of a press. for bending metal. I've just got to mount a plate to that and attach the ram guides to it. Put the press linkage back on it, which is sitting down inside of there. Got some work to do on that guy yet. This here is a shear that I bought off an auction site for, I think I paid about $300 for it. It's got brand new blades on it. They were trying to cut some stainless. That's why it says never ever cut stainless on this shear, and they bent the treadle. So I've got to cut that piece of floor plate off, bend that arm back up where it goes, and replace that floor plate. See there, it's bent. This is a 10-foot brake. I also bought off an auction site, paid $1,400 for it. It's in excellent condition. And I sold my 8-foot brake for $1,400, so I scored on that. Here is my duct notcher, which I paid $250 for. Put a piece of duct in there, and there's a bunch of screws and stuff sitting on it. Like I said, the place is a mess. But you throw the piece of duct in there, push the foot pedal, and it will press out your notches for when you're gonna fold the ductwork up. There's my lead sled that I use when I shoot. I paid $250, I think I may have said that already, for that press. There was a bunch of stuff was kind of bent on it, and I pulled it apart, fixed it, cut this angle iron off the front, and, you know, fixed a couple things, re-welded it back on, and I have notched a ton of ductwork through that guy. This stomp shear I got out of Pahrump, Nevada, from a guy who builds the props and things for Burning Man. I think I paid $1,800 for that. And it works excellent. I built the fence for it. You got these little clamp doodads here so I can set stops for whatever size I want to cut if I'm doing a bunch of repetitive cuts. My sheet metal rack, that cost a little bit of money for the 4-inch angle iron. It's got about 20 sheets of metal on it right now. And also a bunch of crap. And then got a little 4-foot brake I paid $100 for, box and pan brake. You got the other fingers you can throw in there to set it for whatever size of box you're gonna bend up. It works really well. Harbor Freight drill press that I paid, or not a drill press, a bandsaw. I've got it in the vertical position now. But you can lay stuff down in here, clamp it, and take that plate off, put the thing over, and, you know, tip this over this way, and it'll cut stuff off for you. Just turn it on, walk away. It cuts through, hits the start-stop lever right here, and turns off when it's done with the cut. Bullet sizing die press that I made. Here's the little dies. You can put different size ones. And I built these on the lathe to make sure my muzzleloader bullets fit just ever so perfectly. A set of, I think those are Thompson center handles. And I just got a bullet mold that I built for one of my muzzleloaders in there. This is all my casting stuff here, my little lead pot. Some lead ingots that I poured into a muffin tin from some scrap lead that I got. And I've also got some lead ingots here that come out of that little Lee mold. And I've got some big flat chunks of lead that used to be on, I'm guessing those bottom ones were counterbalances off from an elevator. I have a good friend who drops them off to me every once in a while. Here I've got my slitter shear. I'm putting this guy on. Set the fence with the cut you want, put it in, put it through. doing whatever. Whatever side you got it set up. It'll go. Metal's only 10-foot sheets, but it'll, you know, obviously would cut infinite length. Over here to a cleat bender that I bought used. It's a tin knocker, 30-inch. I hated it when I first got it. I thought it was built pretty crappy. I've got a review on one of my other YouTube channels about it. But it does okay. I've been okay with it. Here is my snap lock machine. I get a little bit of crap sitting on top of it. Had the kids and grandkids in here, let them play a little bit, and they were having fun on the break, just kind of bending stuff different. But that's what I use to make the majority of my backpack kit. I'm going to scare a couple of things from that. Over here is my bar folder. It's got a stop that you can set. Put a piece of metal in it here and fold it up over the top. Use that for making drive cleats. To put the ductwork together so that it's mainly what it's used for. Set of slip rolls for turning around collars, which I got also used for, I think I paid $100 for that guy, that Easy Edger, and that guy that makes the crimped edge on collars. And there's this thing down here, it's another metal forming machine that's over 100 years old, still works really well. They used to use it to make buckets with what I understand. That roll there would go into that groove there and turn a groove in the round bucket, which they put a wire in, and there's another set of attachments they put in there and crimp the wire in around the metal bucket. Wilton Vise, really proud of. I got that for $100 a day. Off of Craigslist. My homemade bullet press, reloading press. Built this out of all scrap, with the exception of the fasteners, the bolts. And I bought the dies and the shell holder. This was built mainly, I found a piece of plate that I asked somebody if I could have it. He said, sure, kind of scroungy that way. And the round stuff was off from an underwater treadmill. This guy here is a radius turner that bolts to my big lathe, which I turn the ball for my press on. Toolbox that my kids gave me for birthday or Father's Day or Christmas, I don't remember which. It was nice of them to each of them splurge about $100 to give me that. Rotary table that I got off of eBay. Used to turn hex flats for a bolt or, you know, whatever your imagination can dream of. Here's my Bridgeport mill. Paid $2,500 for that. The guy I got it from had messed the quill up, this part here, and the head. And so I bought this off of eBay from a kid who was just getting into machining. He bought a mill. When they were unloading it, they tipped it off the trailer. Broke that big heavy cast knee right there. And so the mill was essentially useless, so we parted it out and I bought that head. Went through it, cleaned it all up, greased it all up, got new bearings for it. And replaced all that. It turns pretty quiet. Used to be louder than hell. Looks good now. Drill press I paid $40 for from a guy. I don't know why he sold it for $40. He was just getting rid of his stuff. It's a Delta. It's a 2.5-inch. And here's my big Rockford economy lathe. This thing's got a 72-inch capacity. by, I believe, 17. They can spin something 17 inches in diameter, 72 inches long. I paid $2,500 for that guy. It's a monster. And I've built a lot of stuff with him. This Rockwell drill press, here's a variable speed that I bought for $40 from, and it's pretty noisy. It needs some work on the belt, the pulleys. It's got a Reeves drive in it. If any of you know what a Reeves drive is, it's similar to the drive that's on a Polaris belt drive, where one pulley, the faster you go, the more the spring will fly out and let the belt down into the bottom of the pulley. And that's kind of the same principle here. Just adjust the handle here, and that drives the spindle pulley up and lets the belt drive further into it to speed it up. Here's my Grizzly lathe. I paid, I think, $2,800 for this guy. Gunsmithing lathe. I didn't completely crash it, but I had it in gear when I turned it on. The handle started flying around. I grabbed it and I bent a tooth on the gear. Right down, you can't really see it. Get a light on it. That little gear right there that's in the light. It's got a bent tooth, so I've ordered another one of those. When it gets here, I'll have to tear it apart and fix it. Arc welder. I got off of the Craigslist also. I think it hit 250. The guy I got it from, it's a 240 volt, and he said he didn't have 240 volts at his house. He only had 220, so he sold it for it. He paid $110 for it. Move it back over to my insulating table. Kind of copied a Durodyne, the insulation cutter. It's got basically a pizza cutter to pull through the back end. I bought the cutting wheel, the original wheel I made from a small saw blade, and I cut the grinder shaft edge on it. Didn't work so well, so I had to buy an actual cutting blade. I took the rollers, or just rolling head assembly out of just some rolling screws. Rectangular tubing. The handle will spin off and roll the insulation off the wheel, or off the roll. Anyway, to buy that new, which is about a $2,500, $3,000 machine, I built it for like $60. My workbenches, here's my glue pot. I built out of an old propane bottle. Hose comes off the bottom here, is where the glue feeds out. You open that 2-inch ball valve, take the plug out, dump the, screw this funnel here in, dump the glue down in there, close the ball valve, put the air back up, pressurize it. The air comes out of the wall here, goes into the pressure regulator and water separator. From there, it goes through a small check valve down into the tank. The air comes off the top that fans the glue out. It also pressurizes the bottle, which forces the glue through the feed hose up to the gun. The air comes in the back side of the gun, fans out, and it's like ductwork with it. This pin spotter, I got off of eBay. It's probably one of the first things I bought from eBay. Paid $1,000 for it. There again, it's like a probably $6,000-$7,000 machine new. And it's worked so good, it hasn't missed a beat. I did have to replace this little ram down in here, this little pneumatic ram, after a couple of years, and it's what drives the actual head up and down, welds the pins into, through the insulation into the ductwork. Once it's glued on, you know, you spot weld the pins down, that helps hold it on. There's a stack of ductwork that my kids and grandkids actually bent most of the straight duct for me. 10 and 11 years old. He did a great job. Some barrels of scrap, copper, brass, and copper, brass, big piece of brass, fire department connection. You know, a building they were tearing down, I grabbed that, and cast it into rods and discs for machining, bushings, gears, that type of stuff out of. And the last thing I want to show you is my cannon, which I made from an old blower shaft. So here's this guy here. Get it back here, it weighs a ton. The back end threads off here, and it shoots off with a shotgun primer, which you put on in a breech plug that I built in there. Draw the cocking mechanism back, put it against the back end there, put a string through it. You put the string through before you cock it up, obviously. But when you pull the string, releases, lets the firing pin through, hits the shotgun primer, sets the cannon off. It's got a rifled barrel, and the inside of it is pink. And I built all the pivot assembly, the barrel clamp. Inside of that's pink because we used it for my daughter's gender reveal for little Zaylee, when she had little Zaylee. We blasted some pink chalk out of it. It's rifled. It's hard to see the rifling grooves. It's about a 1 in 24 twist, and it shoots that massive slug, just a touch under an inch in diameter. Kick in the pants to shoot. Let's see, I think I missed any of my little trinkets anywhere. So yeah, this is my ever so messy sheet metal shop and fun stuff shop. So anyway, just thought I'd take y'all on a little tour.